Welcome to an invitation to Sisterhood. We want you to join us on a journey as we discuss everyday issues affecting our lives. Women in the Bible and of Christian history continue to have an impact on the world even years after their deaths. We can learn so much from them. They are sisters of inspiration. And we're all sisters, sisters in Christ. On the show today with us is Mary Garlow. Mary holds a master's degree in pastoral studies from Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit. She has more than 20 years of experience in education, catechesis, youth ministry, and evangelization at both the parish and archdiocese level. Mary's the co-founder of Via Maria Consulting, LLC. Via Maria Consulting came into existence for the purpose of helping parishes and organizations build morale amongst their parishioners, employees, and staff by helping them discover their God-given gifts. Through experience, reflection, and prayer, Via Maria helps organizations to accomplish God's will through strengthening collaborative ministry. Our women of inspiration for this show today is Kiera Lupik. Kiera is the founder of the Focolare movement. The charism of this movement is unity, and it is present in 182 countries around the world. She is a remarkable woman of faith who has led countless people to a deeper understanding of Jesus' last prayer, "They all may be one." Finding our charisms. That was such an inspiration for me when I went through that gifted program. And I realized that writing was truly one of my charisms when I could write for hours. And not only was I not tired, I actually was energized. And I know both of you have gone through Finding Your Charisms program and workshop. Did you experience the same thing, that you had that kind of like, oh my gosh, this is a charism, because I could do it all day long and never get tired?
That's right. And it was very interesting to see the various charisms coming out. And I think some of us were together when we went, and we were sort of calling each other's charisms, because they kind of mirror a natural talent.
Sure.
Only that charisms are really gifts from God for us to share in bringing others to Christ. And so some of the things that were natural to me, you know, one of the things, leadership, you know, finding myself in situations where I'm constantly being called upon, hey, Adora, can you do this for us? Or hey, Adora, can you lead this for us? Or hey, can you do that? So when I took that inventory test and realized, you know, that that was one of the, you know, high scoring charisms, I was like, okay, and now I understand more. I understand more. Thank you.
That was my experience as well. I was in awe with that whole workshop, because, you know, there's things that you know about yourself growing up that you do, and you just think, well, I picked this, or I went to school for that. And then to go through the program and to learn that a charism is a gift, a free gift of the Holy Spirit for us to use for our happiness and to glorify God in the world and to manifest God to others. It is so exciting, very exciting.
And know that we're all called to bring others to Christ. We are. We're all called to bring others to Christ. And I didn't understand how to do that. You know, it's like, well, how am I supposed to do that? Yes. I'm not a nun. I'm not a priest. I'm not a minister. I don't know how to do that. And when I realized the Holy Spirit has blessed you with charisms to do just that. Yes. And it doesn't necessarily have to be your vocation. For me, it happens to be. I went to journalism school.
Yes.
So writing became a natural thing for me. But for people watching today who may have discovered their charisms, as we, you know, they may be in a completely different field that has nothing to do with their charisms, but they could still use it to evangelize the faith. We talked about cooking. I mean,
yes,
some people bring such love in their cooking, you could taste it in the food, right?
Yes.
I mean, and so there's so many ways that you can evangelize through the gifts we've been given.
You can.
There's an artist that I'm thinking of who's a 17-year-old senior at St. Catherine's, and she wants to major in biochemistry or science. She's thinking of the medical field. But when she draws a picture, I tell you, there is nothing more beautiful to sit and look at than this child's art. And so even though her vocation may not be, you know, becoming an artist, but that's something that just was awe-inspiring for us to look at.
Sure. Mm-hmm. And we all have those people in our lives that once you've gone through the program and you have an awareness of what the charisms are, It's pretty exciting, just whether it's through your relatives or friends or you're out in the community and you notice something about someone. One of my friends has that charism of craftsmanship, and prior to her taking the workshop, she had no idea about charisms. And I said, you know, I wonder if you took this workshop, you'd probably come out having this charism. But the craftsmanship is everywhere, and it's important for people to go through it, I think, and to have that awareness of what they are, because it gives you a sense of purpose then in your life, right? This is what I was created for. This is what I was created to do. Versus if you are unaware of the fact that it's a charism, you just think, oh, well, I have a hobby for this, or I just enjoy doing this, you know? So it does take it to a completely different level.
Mm-hmm. And I think of the people who sing at church,
yes,
every Sunday, or who play the organ, or who use their God-given talents and their charisms to evangelize, because that is prayer. I mean, when, yes, you sing, you pray twice. And I always envy those people because I do not have a singing voice. And that was one thing I wish I was blessed with, but I'm not. And but I can appreciate that. And I know that when I see, I hear beautiful music and I'm called to even go deeper in faith, that is somebody's charism.
Absolutely. I think about, this thought just came to me about my sister once being in the hospital, and one of the nurses who was taking care of her that day, her name was Gloria, but she did it with such joy. She did it with such love that, you know, I could tell that she really, really enjoyed what she was doing. And so, of course, I began to sing the song, Gloria, and, you know, and I was telling her, you know, you do this so beautifully. Thank, mm-hmm, you. Thank, mm-hmm, you for what you're doing. And she was kind of taken aback because of what I said to her. She didn't realize that, you know, what she was doing was something that God was giving her to do, to, mm-hmm, share. And, mm-hmm, so my sister was receiving God's grace through her gifts, mm-hmm, of giving and caring and service.
And it's beautiful when you can use your charisms in your vocation.
Yeah.
But you don't have to feel like you have to.
Right.
You know, there's so many other things that you can do on a volunteer basis, on the side, whether you go volunteer at the hospital because you feel like, right, one of your charisms is nurturing.
Right.
Yes. Hospitality. Yes. I can think of so many people who are just like, their home becomes Grand Central Station.
That's,
it's like,
right,
they just welcome,
yes,
everybody, you know,
right,
come on over, have food. And,
that's right.
You know, and it's just naturally, and that's how they show love, is, yes, inviting so many people into their homes.
And it's so important because there's a variety of charisms that are so needed. You know, mm-hmm, we can't all have the same gifts.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And when you combine them, it's just pretty amazing to watch how one charism can be that of hospitality or that of administration. And, mm-hmm, it's just so wonderful to see them when they come together.
Absolutely. I think it's fulfilling for the individual who discovers his or her charisms. And then, of course, what happens as far as us as the laity in general, and how all of our different charisms build up the body of Christ in the church.
Mm-hmm.
And because the priests can only do so much, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the role of the laity in terms of the charisms is incredible.
And we're going to talk to Mary Garlow, and she's going to tell us that they're even still discovering all the charisms. They'll give you a list, you'll take the inventory, and we'll talk about that with her. But there are so many more we don't even know are,
yes,
charisms. There's a list,
sure,
that you can look at and say, okay, yeah, that's me. But then I'm sure they're always discovering new charisms.
Absolutely.
That the Holy Spirit has blessed, you know, people with. And that was something new to me, too. It's like, wow, I didn't realize that in baptism I was blessed with this.
That's right.
You know, you think if you're baptized, you're welcome into the Church of Christ, and now we're all a family of Christ. But to know that we're blessed with a gift, and it doesn't have to be one. I think when you guys took it, I had about two or three that were really,
yes,
strong.
Oh, yes.
And that's what I loved about doing the interviews after. I don't know if you guys did the interviews after.
We did, yes.
Because it really, Mary could talk about this, you really delve into,
yes,
and kind of confirm what you believe is your strong charism.
That's right.
And then you kind of discern. We go back to discerning, okay, Lord, now I know this is my charism. What is it I'm supposed to do with it?
Right. That's right. And I think over the years, too, what happens is that we develop our charism. So sometimes, you know, when you're young in life, there's certain charisms that kind of come to the forefront. And then as you grow older, as you become a mother, as you, you know, change jobs or whatever it is that you're doing, I think then the charisms, other charisms that you have may come to the forefront at, mm-hmm, that time.
Absolutely.
So.
I love what Vanessa said about the importance that you mentioned about that we receive these charisms at our baptism. Mm-hmm. So we took this course a few years ago, and ever since then, everyone I come across, especially in family and friends, and especially recently where there's baptisms, and I say to the parents or, you know, the relatives of the person who's getting baptized, do you realize that the Lord is just putting his stamp on this child and he's giving him his vocation, you know, his charisms? And, you know, people look like,
yeah,
really?
And it's so nice that you share that, because think of all the baptisms we have gone to in our life. We're Chaldean.
Yes.
We go to a lot of baptisms, a lot of weddings, a lot of occasions. I have never thought of it that way.
Yes.
And can you imagine you telling the parents that?
Yes.
Because now you could help those parents, help those children bring those charisms out and
identify them. That's right. Because as parents, if we don't have the eye to see, we're not looking for it. If we don't know, we don't know what we're looking for. So it's so important to have that eye into, as they're growing up, if you see tendencies towards a certain charism, and to encourage them in that way and to move them in that direction.
And don't you find that when you do mention to somebody, you know, you may have the charism of mercy, mm-hmm. how their ears perk up, their eyes open wide, because
Absolutely.
What you're saying to them is the truth, and their soul is recognizing that. Even
yes.
though they may not have heard it before,
yes.
as soon as you speak those words, it's like something opens inside of them.
Absolutely.
And it goes back to Ichlas's point, and your background as a therapist too, Ichlas, everybody wants to have a purpose.
That's right.
Right?
Of course.
And everybody wants to feel that they're on this earth for a reason.
Yes.
And I think you have probably in your therapy sessions have found that people struggle with identity crisis or not knowing what they're meant. Can you imagine if everybody's just understood their charisms?
Yes.
If we taught this, I'm excited to ask Mary this, how young, I mean, should we be giving this workshop to teenagers?
Right.
I mean, that's where you see identity crisis
yes.
happening. Like,
yes.
what am I doing? Where am I going? Who
yes.
am I supposed to be?
Yeah. Yes. You know, now more than ever, the point that you're making is so true, because there's such a rise in the different mental disorders. There's a rise in drug abuse in society. There's a rise in suicide. I mean, one of my relatives is a prosecutor in one of the counties and was talking about how he's never in his career seen so many young people and even young girls addicted to heroin at the age of 16 mm-hmm. and 17. I mean, you just didn't hear about that, you know, decades ago. And so it is, I think, people discovering their charisms is more important now than ever before.
Mm-hmm.
And it does have to do with, you know, those two questions that are on everybody's mind. Who am I and what is my purpose? Why am I here? What is the meaning of life?
Mm-hmm.
And that's why people struggle with their identity. That's why people struggle with their purpose, because they don't have that sense of direction. And you know what you said, Adora, earlier about the truth and resonating in people, it's true. It's St. John Paul II that said in his encyclical, The Splendor of Truth, that the nature of truth longs to reveal itself. And so when that truth is revealed, then it does speak to the heart and soul of that person, and something happens.
That's
because
right.
of the power of the Holy Spirit in that conversation, in that encounter.
Mm-hmm.
And so it does. There's so many implications for people to understand what their gifts are and how they can you know, bring them into the world.
And I know for me, it gave me a sense of peace. It really did within myself.
Yes.
Knowing, okay, God, this is what you gave me. And we all have that.
Yes.
We all should find that peace in our charism. So we're going to continue this conversation. We're going to bring Mary Garlow in and talk with her about finding our charism. Stay with us, everyone. And we're back. Welcome to Invitation to Sisterhood. We're talking about finding your charisms. And to talk with us about that is Mary Garlow from Via Marie Consulting. Mary, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. I'm delighted to be here.
We're really excited to talk about finding our charisms. We all kind of took similar workshops, and
mm-hmm.
we're really excited when we all discovered what our charisms are. But for our audience, explain what is a charism and why is it important to discover it?
Well, Vanessa, a charism is actually a special gift that comes to us at baptism. It's a gift of the Holy Spirit, completely unmerited, given freely, lavishly. The Holy Spirit lavishes these gifts on the people of God. You know, at baptism, we receive the seven gifts of the Spirit, wisdom and courage and counsel and piety and fortitude and you know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Well, and then in addition to that, the Holy Spirit gets really creative and sends out these charisms. And the charisms, while the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit are for our own personal growth and holiness, the charisms that come to us through the Holy Spirit at baptism are actually gifts that are given for the good of another person. So it's important to discover these, because in our journeys, as we come into this world, at the moment we are conceived, there's a purpose for our being here. There's a purpose, there's a mission, there's something that we're here to do. And then when we're invited into relationship with Jesus through baptism, we are given through baptism, we are kind of engaged to Jesus, basically, engaged to the mission of Jesus. And then through that, these charisms are manifested. Mm-hmm. So as we walk with Jesus in faith, these charisms are manifested. And it's important to just kind of take time to reflect and look at them, to really discover, you know, why am I here? How am I connected to the mission of Jesus? Mm-hmm. And how can I better serve him?
So when you say the mission of Jesus, is it ultimately to evangelize the faith and bring others to him so we all can live in the kingdom of God? Is that basically the ultimate goal?
Well, Jesus came on earth. Basically, you know, it was always God's plan that he would send his son to live with us. Had Adam and Eve not said no to the plan and cut God off, basically, then they would have had a son, and his name would have been Emmanuel. We read about that in the book of Isaiah.
Right.
God with us.
Right.
But that didn't happen, so God had to, he's going to keep his plan. He ain't going to change his mind. So God so loved the world that he kept his plan, right? And he sent his son. He waited patiently. And the Blessed Mother Mary finally said yes, with no strings attached. So he patiently waited, and Mary said yes, and then brought forth Jesus. Now his name wasn't Emmanuel now, because it's now Jesus, which means Yahweh saves. So as a consequence of Jesus' coming to the world, living with us, being rejected by both the church and state, so to speak, that he unified them in a funny sort of way. They both rejected him. They both agreed they were going to get rid of him. And as a consequence of that, he redeemed our human nature and raised us to the proper dignity that would have always been ours,
right,
had the fall not occurred. So, of course, when we know the story, too, as Jesus lived out his mission, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he sent the Holy Spirit to be with us for always. He gave us the Eucharist as that food for our mission. So there's a couple ways that Jesus set up that he's going to remain with us and stay in the world with us. One of them, of course, being the Eucharist. Very important, the Eucharist. That food for us, when we receive the Eucharist, we take that out into the world, so that the world can consume that. It's not about us getting to heaven. It's about Jesus getting into the world. And then these charisms. He works through us, manifests through us in these special charisms that are activated kind of when they are called forth from us. When we meet the person for whom that charism has been given, it's called forth out of us. So that's why we say it's important to reflect, to try to remain in a state of grace, which the church gives us method to do that through the sacramental life of the church, and stay in tune.
So you're saying, Mary, if someone needs to always remain in a state of grace in order to have access, if you will, to their charisms.
Well, it helps
to manifest.
It certainly helps because they are manifested to us as we walk with Jesus.
Okay.
I mean, you know, God can do anything. So it's, you know, it's hard to say, you know, it's only in this way that this is going to happen, because we know that God is big and God can do anything. Mm-hmm. But certainly our connection with Jesus, and we'll talk a little bit, I guess we can talk a little bit more about that, is going to be stronger when we connect with the one who gave us this gifts.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And so, Mary, when people begin to realize that they have these God-given gifts, how is it that they can strengthen these gifts or exercise them, if you will? Can you talk about that?
Again, there it's a movement of the Holy Spirit within us.
Right.
And as we, I guess what I'm thinking is, so when we're baptized, we are engaged into the mission of Jesus. We're connected into that mission of Jesus and his resurrection. Mm-hmm. When we're confirmed, we're bound more closely to the mission of the church. Mm-hmm. And when we receive the Eucharist, we receive that food for the mission.
Mm-hmm.
So as we are sent out on mission, it's important always to know how to connect with the one who sends us on mission.
Right.
God is the one that sends us on mission. So in our workshop that we do, in our Discovering Your Gifts workshop, we really dive into prayer techniques and abilities to connect with the one who sends us on mission.
Okay.
It's so important to do that, because then we are going to, we're going to learn to reflect on experience, things that happen to us as we're walking this journey of faith, how things make us feel, and we start to be able to kind of filter out what is of God, what is not, what is part of my mission, maybe what's not, and start to, it's a discerning process. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Does it kind of help? And I think when you say experiences, I think too, on the same note, that we're affirmed as we're discovering what our charisms are, because people
very
will say,
so,
you know, you're great at this, or you're great at that, or, you know, you bring so much joy to people by your humor. I think about my son, you know, my youngest one, who's, you know, wakes up singing in the morning and is so full of joy. And it's just, you know, the family comedian. He's just so funny. And I know that these are these are some of the gifts that he has, and they're not just for him, they're for all of us, you know, to remind us to laugh, remind us to, have that joy, the childlike joy, you know, that he brings into the world. And I can assure you that he will carry it on to his adulthood.
Right.
Because that is one of the gifts the Holy Spirit has given him. So,
well, that's identifying that, like Mary, I want to ask you, so she identifies this in her son, she sees this. How are we as parents, or what age do we encourage our children to take your workshop so they can discern and discover their charisms? As we were talking prior to you coming on, there's so much confusion among teenagers.
That's right.
So, you know, Adora identifies this in her son. So at what age should he be taking the workshop and really hone in on this charism and use it for the good of others?
That's a really good question. And what we like to suggest is exactly what you just defined for us. Parents, catechists, youth ministers, people that teachers that work with children, it's really important for them to have this language, because they affirm it in the people, in the children that
that's
they work. And they can say, you know, this is connected to your baptism. They can kind of keep that conversation going about what is the effects of the baptism. And I've seen that even in my little granddaughter when she was 3 years old. I watched her do something that made me think she might have a mercy charism.
Oh, yes.
You know, obviously, she hasn't lived long enough to know that exactly. But for parents to be able to affirm that and call that forth with their children, I think is so, so important. The inventory that we provide when we do our workshop, it is to a fairly large extent based on life experience.
Okay.
So it's going to ask some questions about the feedback that you've received, things about experiences, how you felt in doing these kinds of things. So if a person is really young, obviously they're not going to have that much feedback, that life experience yet. So that's why it's not necessarily the best thing to give to a really young person, because they haven't had that life experience.
Right.
But obviously the parent, the adults that work with them
have
the ability to affirm and use the language for the charisms to start the conversation going. I have seen young adults, I've given this to young adults, and I have seen them benefit from it, you know, early 20s or so. They've had enough life experience, they kind of know themselves fairly well, not, you know, not completely yet, but they know themselves fairly well, and they have found it beneficial. They've found it eye-opening, that's helped them to become a little bit more aware about their own characteristics and how God has been active in their life up until this point. But again, you know, we always remind them, charisms can manifest at any time. We may have a charism that we have that hasn't been called forth from us yet, because we haven't met the person for whom it's been given. So what happens with the process is that awareness of how this works, how these are coming forth from us, so that throughout our life we can discern. This is a lifetime project, you know, to discern our charisms and how God is working within, how we are connected to the mission of Jesus Christ and moving ahead that way.
And with charisms, so you said that some have not yet manifested, but then you think about some that you've had, you can think about them from your childhood. You think, oh, maybe that's why I reacted that way at that time, or maybe that's why I felt this way. When you think back on experiences throughout your life, and you've identified your charisms, I think that that helps you understand more about who you are and why you interpreted those experiences as you did, you know, in your youth, as your, you know, as a young adult, as a mother, as a wife. And I just think it's so important. And like you said, there's times in our lives where we haven't met that person, but there's other times where all of a sudden we find ourselves on this other path. You know, you're heading down this road, you've chosen this path, and then all of a sudden you realize that there's something else taking place. And I think it's the work of the Holy Spirit in us through our charisms that we discover how important it is to be who we are and who God called us to be, so that people can also see that and be encouraged by it. So,
well, sometimes we need role models too. We always have a woman of inspiration, and Mary, you picked Kiara Lupik for us, and you and your co-founder of Via Maria, Judy Mayton, picked. And tell us about her, and why is she a good woman of inspiration for us on Charisms?
Well, Kiara Lupik was a young woman of about 23 when World War II was raging. She lived in Trent, Italy. And Trent was one of the most heavily bombed cities in all of Europe during World War II. So you can imagine the death and destruction in this particular part of the world. So there she was, this this young woman, and all her she and her earliest companions saw their dreams just crumbling before them. One woman dreamed really of being married and having a family and a house, and her fiancé never came back from the front lines. Kiara herself dreamed of going to study at university, study theology and philosophy, and the war made that impossible. So they found themselves wondering, what is the one ideal worth devoting our lives to that can never be destroyed by any bomb?
That's right.
So at that point, the answer really came quickly to them, and it was God. God is the only ideal. So they said, we will live for God. Let's devote our lives for God. And they set out to bring the gospel to life concretely in any way they possibly could. And that really started in the bomb shelters. So they'd go into the bomb shelters with just a little New Testament in hand, open it up, whatever scripture came to their attention, they would try to live that as concretely as possible. Love your neighbor. Let me help that woman. She's got five children. They're terrified. I will help her. This man needs some shoes. I'm going to go find some shoes. And they found God just kept providing. So little by little, this their following grew. More and more people wanted to experience what they were experienced, and they were given the name Focolare, which means hearthside, fireplace in mm-hmm. Italian, because of the love that was radiating forth from this little apartment that they lived in. So what happened, though, what really became the Magna Carta scripture for Chiara and her earliest companions was Jesus' last prayer in John chapter 17, verse 21, where he said, "May they be one as you and I are one, so that the world may believe that you sent me." Mm-hmm. So this is Jesus' last prayer, and they said, this is what we will live for. Mm-hmm. And God revealed a spirituality built around that. So they really, this charism came into the world at a time when the world was torn apart by greed and violence. Yes. This charism was breathed into the world through this young woman by the power of the Holy Spirit to build universal brotherhood. And so now this movement is found, it's the largest movement in the church. It's found in 182 countries, as you had said. Mm-hmm. It boasts of about 5+ million followers.
That's unbelievable.
It's translated, you know, the word of life that is lived, a scripture verse every month, is translated into multiple languages. So across the globe, you know, about 5 million people are trying to live concretely a particular scripture verse. So that's an example of how the Holy Spirit breathes something in a collective way, a charism that's in a collective way. And the Holy Spirit knows what the world needs at mm-hmm. any given time throughout the course of human history, of the mm-hmm. church history. And this is one example mm-hmm. of that happening.
What a great woman of inspiration.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I want to go read more about her. And it's just really fitting for our invitation to sisterhood when you talk about brotherhood, because that's what mm-hmm. this is all about, is bringing others to the sisterhood so we all can follow Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And what you said about hope, mm-hmm. I think it's so important now more than ever with all the things going on in the world, with the different violence and wars and mm-hmm. persecutions everywhere. Mm-hmm. The fact that the Holy Spirit knows mm-hmm.
yes.
in every time and age
that's right.
what the church needs
that's
and
right.
brings forth those people and those gifts to continue to carry out that mission. So
yes.
there is no reason to despair. There is no reason
right.
to be afraid. There is no reason to worry, because
right.
the Holy Spirit is always there and always will be, mm-hmm. as God promised.
And mm-hmm. as confirmed Christians, Catholic Christians in the world, we're bound up with that very mission.
Yes.
And we have a place in that.
Yes.
A very mm-hmm. important part to play.
What I love about what you said, the meaning, Focolare, mm-hmm. the meaning mm-hmm. means hearth, you mm-hmm. know, the fire, the light, the warmth. And
yes.
I think a lot of times when you're doing what God has called you to do, people magnate towards the light. Mm-hmm. They magnate towards the love. They magnate towards
exactly.
the warmth.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So it's very interesting, and I'm
yes.
sure very purposeful that they named it Focolare.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, we don't even know it. I mean, we are called. Yeah. I mean, we're attracted. It is that attractive force.
That's right.
And because God is in the DNA of every single human person.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
We all
right.
have a place in our hearts that can only be filled by God.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So we're all drawn to that universal force of love.
That's right.
Well, we know people in our lives that really draw a lot of people towards them. You could see mm-hmm. when they're so holy, we say, but they're really truly blessed
yes.
by the Holy Spirit and living out their charisms. I mean,
yes.
one of the people I think of is Bishop Francis, mm-hmm. our bishop in the Chaldean
yeah.
community.
Sure.
Yeah.
Long before he was ordained a bishop, when he was a priest, he had this huge following.
Yeah.
And it's because you see this holiness in him, and you want to say, what is it that you have? I want what you have,
That's
you know?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And people like that, like Bishop Francis and Pope Francis, our Pope Francis too,
That's
and
right.
Mother Teresa, all these people are showing all of us that you too can have the same peace and the same love if you find your charisms, if you discover it. And
mm-hmm.
truly live out God's calling. And that's mm-hmm. what I love about
mm-hmm.
the workshops that you do, because mm-hmm. every single person needs to take a workshop like this.
Sure.
You talked about a class that was probably one of the best workshops mm-hmm. when you took it. Is when you take the workshop, it's there's really a sense of purpose. You're like, okay,
yes.
I found peace in myself, because I thought, okay, now God, I know.
Yeah.
You blessed me with this gift through the Holy Spirit. Now show me what I'm supposed to do with it.
It can really set you free.
Mm-hmm. It can. And I think about, you know, a project that somebody is doing, you know, whether it's art or whether it's, you know, you're building a table. You need the proper tools to be able to carry out, you know, the completion of that little task or that job.
Very good.
And I think with us realizing what our charisms are, it's sort of the tools in the tool belt that, you know, we weren't sure exactly what they were, but it's like, oh, okay, I have this. Now I know what I need to do with it.
Sure.
And so that's what I liken it to. And I just feel like it gives us that edge, if you will, instead of saying, okay, Lord, what am I supposed to do? Mm-hmm. You know, you're saying, okay, Lord, this is one of my gifts. I know what to do now. I'm going to go and, you know, go out into the world
and
use it.
God.
That's right.
And that, and we all the gifts, there's no gift that's more important than the other.
Right.
They're all equally and vitally important and necessary for the building up of the kingdom.
That's right.
They all complement one another.
Mm-hmm.
So in the body of Christ, everyone has an equally vital, important role to play. So there's no room for ego in all of this.
No. Which I love.
You know, we have
to
set that aside and know that this isn't really us doing this. This is the Holy Spirit, which is really quite remarkable to think about, you know.
When you give this workshop, Mary, what when you see the reaction of people, do you see that sense of peace, that sense of aha, that sense of, oh, thank God, I now I know?
Yes.
And how do you work with them after that? Because you can't just take the workshop and say, okay, bye. You
know what I mean? No, Yeah, the workshop does kind of go through the process of introducing this idea that we are all given charisms at our baptism and we're sent on mission through our confirmation. And these charisms are vital to our mission and our purpose and our vocation and all that good stuff. But we also know that it's a starting point. There's a discernment process that has to take place. Just, you know, because God is constantly dynamic, constantly working at us. He's never finished with us. There will always be charisms coming forth from us as we journey through our faith life. But people do find it does open them up. It does set them free. It gives them a connectedness and a purpose for mission, which is just, you know, in the world that we live in today, and with evangelization being so much in the hands of the lay faithful, this is a really important tool. So then in the workshop, we do dive into the prayer and discernment piece as well. Tools to kind of take with you to continue on, techniques and things that will help continue to uncover what God is doing.
And then you do follow up with interviews too.
Yes, we do the, we will do the follow up one-on-one consultations to help look more deeply at an individual's experience of faith and what is going on with their life and why we feel maybe one charism seems to be manifesting stronger here. You know, look through experience and reflection and prayer, those kinds of things. And just kind of unpack it together with really what Jesus in the midst. You know, where two or three are gathered, in my name Jesus is there with. Mm-hmm. So when we come together for that purpose of discovering how God is working in our life, my experience has just been amazing what has come forth out of it. I never know what's going to come forth out of those consultations. I never know what's going to come forth out of the workshops either.
Absolutely,
you know?
Absolutely.
But it is very eye-opening and very affirming because it's the work of God.
Mm-hmm. And you probably change lives and you'll never know the countless lives you change.
I think all of us, exactly, through our charisms especially. Mm-hmm. And we're not supposed to. I think we might get prideful.
But you know, it's funny when you talk about that, I think when we're, you know, discussing our charisms and, you know, kind of picking out in each other what we see as the strengths or the possible charisms, I think that we encourage one another and that we're proud of each other and that we uplift each
other.
And that there really is no pride of self, but it's the pride that comes in discovering the gifts that God gave us to share with each other. Yeah. You know, when she writes an amazing article or when she's, you know, public speaking somewhere or when you're, you know, in your workshop, when I'm leading the kids that I'm working with, it's just so uplifting and encouraging for us. And I think as a group, that's so important for us to continue to do and to help each other, you know, and our family and our children and everybody around us discover their gifts, because how much stronger would we be as a community?
And how much can we change the world? Sorry.
Exactly.
I was going to say, that's why community is absolutely essential in discovering what our gifts are. We can't do that. Nobody learns in a vacuum.
Yeah. No.
We all learn through the community of faith.
That's right.
That's why I love that scripture from John, that they all may be one. Mm-hmm. So there isn't room for that ego. You realize that the purpose of everything that we're doing with our charisms is for that unification and for that building up of the kingdom.
Yes.
And so I think for women, it's important for us to remind ourselves all the time, and then when we're encouraging other women in the community to kind of have that at the forefront of our minds, because let's face it, there's a lot of things that are distracting women now that are keeping us away from discovering what our purpose may be and what our mission may be.
There's a lot of distractions.
Yeah.
And imagine if you knew your charisms and you stay focused on that. When you talked about praying, and it's praying every day, God, give me, you know, the strength or the courage to live out my charisms, to do your will, to bring others to you. Mm-hmm. And I think if you stay focused on that, you're less likely to get distracted by what's going on in the world every day. Because it's easy to get distracted.
Yeah, it sets you free. You're not, you won't be so self-absorbed.
Yeah.
Because it's all directed out.
Yes.
It's all directed out. And it's a whole, life is a lot more fun.
Yes.
When you live it that way.
Yes. A lot less stressful, a lot more peaceful.
Let's face it, because as women, we do have a tendency to be controlling and hovering, as we said before, right? Uh-huh. But I love I love what you're saying. I know, not I. I love that. I love the freedom of it. I love the detachment of it.
Yeah.
That when you do let go and, you know, let God run his purpose in your life, that it is. It's like a weight lifted off your shoulder.
Yeah.
You know?
The process is so important, you know, and like we said, the prayer, and, you know, you realize that in praying, you know, that all of these things begin to happen. But sometimes, I'll tell you, when I'm praying, I argue with God and I'm like, you want me to do what?
Yes.
And I think it's in knowing who we are and continuing that personal relationship that, you know, the things that God is calling us to do, sometimes that we think about them, you know, there could be a little bit of fear or apprehension. But then when we think, you know what, I'm carrying out the will of God.
Yeah.
And you know what? If Kiara could do it, I could do it. Because as we know, she was one person. And there's how many millions of people in this movement? Mm-hmm. One person in the community can make all the difference in the world.
You know, and it just reminds me of that old thing, when one door closes, another opens, or
that's
a window
right.
opens. It's because God is moving you into the direction he wants you to go.
That's
so
right.
So he closes this door saying, you know what, that's not really what I want you to do.
Right.
That's not what the Holy Spirit blessed you to do. Right. I need you to move in this direction.
Right.
That's what Mary was saying about how dynamic God is and how creative God is, that he's always
moving us.
And infinite. You know, this is, like you had said earlier, we don't know how many charisms there are, because this is an infinite God. There are infinite amounts of charisms.
For people with like a little mind like mine, you know, who limit God, you know, sometimes I limit God because I think, oh, well, that can't happen.
Well, it's human nature to limit God, because we can't comprehend the magnitude of God.
But then you see something that happens in an instant moment. And you think to yourself, that is only by the grace of God.
Of course. And little prayers.
Yes.
And you just know that God's hand is in there when little things change. And it's like the power of prayer is just amazing. Mm-hmm. You were talking in class about, you know, getting into our ego, sometimes getting in our way. And I think when you really discover your charisms and know that you have a purpose, you're not only moving your ego out, you're less offended by people that try to hurt you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we talk about sisterhood. It's because there's been such a lack of sisterhood in the world today.
That's right.
Where we carry each other and help each other. Like you said, a door lifting each other up. And Mary, you know, saying that, you know, we need to focus on the greater good, the glory of God. Yeah.
Right.
And when you're focused on that and somebody does try to backstab you, I'm in the world. Okay.
Right.
So I have another job where I do communications. And there's a lot of people that try to undermine you, or women that are very competitive, or they think you're stealing their thunder or whatever it is. when you're really focused on what your purpose is, you're less likely to get offended by those people. Mm-hmm. Do you find that to be true? I mean,
I do. I think it's like wearing a protective shield of armor. So no matter what arrows the devil is shooting at you, you're able to withstand it and walk forward with your held with your head held high, because you're not doing it for you. Mm-hmm. You know who you're doing it for. Mm-hmm. You're doing it for the glory of God.
Mm-hmm. We're surrounded by the consequences of fallen human nature.
That's right. Sure.
You know,
sure.
And so it's important for us to remember who we are. We are people of the resurrection.
That's right.
We are the force of redemptive love that is coming into the world. Yeah, you know, that's what God has connected and called us to do. And you know, I was thinking of this story with Kiara, speaking of these charisms manifesting themselves. She told the story of meeting with this priest that she would meet with regularly, and the priest asked her, Kiara, when do you think it was that Jesus suffered the most? And she said, well, maybe the agony in the garden. And and he said, no, it was when he was hanging on the cross and he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Mm-hmm. When he felt separated even from his God the Father, that everybody had abandoned him. Now this became, Jesus forsaken became a key point in the spirituality of the Focolare that just unfolded as time went on, as the spirituality grew. And that priest says, I have no idea where that came from. I had never even thought of that before.
Wow.
So at that point, there was a prophetic message. Mm-hmm. He was the channel of a prophetic message to this young woman, Kiara, who then would be the founder of this vast movement that would spread throughout the globe. You know, it's just really, it's really cool, isn't it?
It is great, because then that's the whole message. When you're separated from God is when you're in most agony.
Yes,
really. Yes. When we're separated from our Creator is when we are in most pain.
That's what the definition of hell is. To be separated from God.
Yes. So. I was going to say that. I learned that through the St. Catherine of Siena's spirituality recently. Listening to her talks and the visions that she got, that was what the Lord showed her. Was complete separation from him, and that was the definition of hell.
And there was one of Kiara's earliest followers too, Eugenio Giordani was his name, and he spent his life looking for a Catherine of Siena to follow. And he was so moved by Catherine of Siena and her her faith and boldness, and then he met Kiara and he said, I found her.
Isn't
that something?
That's
beautiful.
Well,
before we let you go, Mary, any last words of advice or encouragement for our viewers in terms of discovering your charisms and why it's so important to do so?
Well, just to reiterate that we are invited to be into baptism. We're invited to be connected with the mission of Jesus, and we are bound together through our confirmation with the mission of the church. And knowing our charisms, studying them, reflecting on our life experience is going to really help us in living out the mission and the purpose for which we've been created for, and for which God is calling us to accomplish here on earth.
Well, thank you so much for joining us here on Invitation to Sisterhood.
Well, thank you for having me.
Wonderful. Stay with us, everyone. We're going to continue our conversation. And as always, we won't leave the show without giving you our Sisterhood Pledge. Stay with us. Welcome back to An Invitation to Sisterhood. We've been talking about finding your charisms. Thank you so much, Mary Garlow, for being with us today. You know, I have to tell you, we talked about this. One of the best things we ever did, I did, was take that charism, finding your charisms, because it really did set me free, as Mary had said, and helped me find peace within myself. And I just kept thinking the whole time she was talking, if everybody just could take this workshop, there'd be peace in this world.
That's right. Because we'd all know what our purpose is in serving each other and serving the common good of the people of Jesus Christ.
Especially as women, I think it's very, very important for us to go through this process of researching what is a charism, researching how do I discover my charisms, you know, look at the program, because we are in a lot of ways through our feminine genius called to play such an important role in evangelization. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, can you evangelize without truly knowing your charisms? That's a good question.
Absolutely. That's a really good question. You might be doing it without knowing it. Because we are blessed with these charisms, and sometimes we're using them without knowing them because we're moved to do so.
Yes. Right.
I mean, I was writing long before I even knew what a charism was.
Yes.
Right. I mean, you too, Ichlas. Yes. I mean, you were using your charisms before you know. Yes. Your son Luke is using his charism as humor before he really understands what charism means, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So we're all doing that, but maybe not at the level we need to because we don't know what they are.
Yes. That's right.
Yeah, it's a huge difference when you think in terms of your writing, for example. I mean, how incredible was it to, you know, you go to this workshop and you've already been writing and you've already been published to some extent, mm-hmm. and you're thinking you chose this, and then all of a sudden it turns out that writing is one of your charisms, mm-hmm. that it was an actual gift that was given to you at your baptism, that God gave you that gift intentionally, mm-hmm. uniquely, just for you to mm-hmm. carry out, you know, help carry out his mission in the world. So it takes it from like this level to way up here.
Sure.
That's right.
And you're just like, it's empowering, mm-hmm. it's uplifting, it's edifying, mm-hmm. it's unifying, it's...
And like we said, you don't feel like it's work when I'm writing, when I'm communicating, because communicating was another one for me. I never feel exhausted. I feel That's exhilarated.
Right. That's right.
I feel very happy and energized.
That's
and
right.
Opposed to, you know, when you're working. I remember working in the store at the cash register.
You're like, okay, is it time to go yet? Is it 10 o'clock?
Out of here.
Time to go.
But then you talked about a nurse who I would watch the clock at a hospital.
Right.
You know, I couldn't do that. Right. But then there's nurses probably puts in a 12-hour shift and it's like no time went by.
That's right. Yeah. That's
right. You know, because she's truly called to do that.
That's right. And again, in thinking about my youngest son with his charism of humor, he doesn't know it yet. Mm-hmm. He knows that he's funny. He mm-hmm. loves, you know, to make other people laugh. Mm-hmm. He just wants to be, you know, constantly in that spirit of joy. Mm-hmm. And I think the magnetic feeling that we get from watching Pope Francis mm-hmm. has a lot to do with the way that he is, how joyful he is, the way he takes the little baby and embraces the baby and kisses and hugs mm-hmm. the baby, or how he is with the poor. You know, you think about Holy Thursday and all the various people whose feet he washed, you know, mm-hmm. and you think of the charism of mercy. So our eyes are then opened. Our eyes, the eyes of our soul is what we begin to see with after we've discovered our own charisms, because we want others to discover theirs so that they can go out into the world too and make it a better place and mm-hmm. work towards the common good of the church mm-hmm. unified under Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And I love your word magnetic, because it truly is. When somebody is living out their charisms and evangelizing the faith through them, you are drawn
That's right.
to that person. It's
That's
very
right.
magnetic.
That's right.
And I always wonder why I was always so drawn to Mother Teresa,
right.
why I always wanted to know her. I wish there was one right. person who passed away.
Yes.
Pope John Paul II, saint
sure.
is another one, who I would have loved to have sat down. You know when they say,
sure.
if there's anybody dead that you could sit down and have dinner with, who would
yes.
it be? I would be torn between St. Pope John Paul and Mother Teresa. Because you're so drawn to those people.
Absolutely. And on that note, Vanessa, one of my sister-in-laws did have the blessing of meeting Pope John Paul in person. Mm-hmm. And she said that right when he walked into the room, before she even sort of turned her head towards him, there was a light that emanated from him. There was like a magnetism. The Holy
That's
Spirit
amazing.
Was just beaming out of every pore of him. And you knew it. You could feel it physically and mm-hmm. you could see it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so I think the beauty of discovering your charisms is just that. You're mm-hmm. bringing back the joy of the gospel mm-hmm. because you're living out the gospel, because you're using the gifts that God has given you for the greater good, for our children, for their friends, for our neighbors, for everybody around us in our community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think the magnetism that you talk about is, it's just... it's the Holy Spirit manifesting,
sure,
right?
Absolutely.
It's the Holy Spirit manifesting, and that's one of the characteristics of the Holy Spirit, is that he unifies, right?
That's right.
And when we think in terms of that, and then we think in terms of, okay, what when I'm doing something that is not glorifying God, or if I'm being a certain way where I'm not following in his path, then the opposite happens. And we've seen this, and we see it every day, whether it's at work, sometimes in our families, in the community, where the opposite happens. And then instead of unification and joy, you have division.
That's right.
And you have strife, and you have a lack of peace, and you have all these other things that are not of the Spirit.
That's right.
And it just, it's profound to me how this whole, the whole thing of the charism works in this way. And also to think that if you use your charism to do evil in the world, it will cease.
That's
your
right.
charism
yeah.
will not
will
work.
Will not work.
Yeah.
How
for
amazing
the harm
is
of
that
others.
To think
no
in
way.
Yeah.
you know, those terms?
Yeah, we forgot to really elaborate on that, because we've talked about that in the past, Ikhlas, about people, you can't use your charisms for bad,
no.
for bad things.
No.
Mm-hmm. And what I love about the charisms and what Mary talked about is that there's so many. We don't know the number of charisms in
that's
the world.
Right. Yeah.
And so maybe you don't identify with that particular list that's in front of your face, but you have a charism.
Yeah. That's right.
You're blessed by the Holy Spirit upon baptism with one or two, three or four, whatever it may be.
Right.
We just may not have the name for it on that list yet.
That's right.
And so there's so many things that you can discover and know, I can use this for the greater good, whether it be working with your hands,
right.
craftsmanship,
right.
administration,
right.
mercy.
Right.
We talked about this guy I knew that at one of the workshops, he said that I'm called in the middle of the night to pray for people,
right.
intercessory prayer. I mean, he probably will never know the lives he touched.
That's right.
Just because the Holy Spirit's calling him to pray for people.
That's right.
So I just think it's wonderful. And I love the fact that what this helped me understand this show is that I now could help people identify
that's right.
their charisms.
Yes.
Whether it be my own daughter, siblings, my nieces and my nephews, I get excited to say, you know, you're blessed with this. Sometimes people, we see in each other what we don't see in ourselves.
Yes.
Right?
Right?
I mean,
yes.
you know, and so we need to help other people discover those.
We do.
Encourage them to take the workshops.
I think we have to be careful, though, and I'm saying that because of the experience I had.
Okay.
I don't know what yours was in the beginning, but so when you go through the program, you know, like Judy, like Mary said, you know, that's the starting point. And then you have to go through prayer.
Sure.
You have to go through discernment. And sometimes when you're, let's say you scored your top, you know, six charisms and you start, you know, praying and discerning and exercising them, sometimes those change, right? So,
sure.
So sometimes because of my zeal, I've gone and said, well, I think you have this charism, that charism, you know?
But maybe you can just encourage somebody to take the workshop.
Absolutely, but saying, you know, I think you may have this charism.
Yeah, yes,
I think you might, you know, looking into this.
Yes.
That's your therapist coming up.
Yeah.
That's your therapist hat.
Yeah, her therapist hat is coming.
But you know, one of the words you used, Vanessa, was exhilarating.
Uh-huh.
And that's it. That's the word that I can use to describe when you are doing the work of the Lord and you're using the gifts that He has given you, it's not work. It's something life-changing, and there's a feeling inside of you, and I'm sure there's a feeling that we all get from each other of exhilaration that only the Holy Spirit can give us, the
and
consolation and affirmation.
Absolutely. Not only that, Sherry Waddell has said it in the past, who was the original creator of the Called and Gifted program, that our hearts are going to be restless until they start, until we find our charisms, and until we exercise our charisms, there will always be this restlessness. And it's like, you know, one of our other guests had said in another show where she was an engineer, and that was the path that she took.
Well, it's Mary's partner.
Yes,
until she
discovered her charisms.
Yeah.
And then that's when, you know, that restlessness went away, and that was filled with, you know, that sense of joy and peace and exhilaration.
Well, that's why I loved Mary bringing up Kiera as our woman of inspiration.
Yes.
Because she, too, all the doors were being closed for them.
That's right.
Because of the war going on and the bombs happening, that she was moving in another direction. And then she found her purpose.
Yes.
That's right.
I mean, what a great woman of an inspiration. I want to go read more about her.
And sometimes it's in the simplest things, Vanessa. They started out with just one verse, walking into one place and changing one person's life. And, you know, I think sometimes when we talk about charisms or evangelization or the work of the Lord, sometimes people are intimidated because they think it's this, you know, huge thing that they have to undertake.
Overwhelming.
No, it's just your simple way of being you and loving others
through God.
And you really do find peace.
Absolutely.
You really do find peace. Well, we will not end the show, as always, without giving our sisterhood pledge.
Yes.
It was a wonderful show. Thanks again to Mary, and thanks, ladies, again,
thank you,
for
Vanessa.
Being on the show, my co-host. Stay with us, everyone. We're going to come back, and we're going to give you our sisterhood pledge.
I pledge to pray about where God is calling me to be the light in the world today. I pledge to pray for the grace to love each person who God puts in my path with no strings attached. I pledge to pray that I will discover my charisms.